Well, tax cuts are the big focus of Finance Minister Nicola Willis's first budget. She set out $14.7 billion to pay for those tax cuts and rebates over 4 years. Let's simplify what Kiwis will get. A family of two adults and two children earning a combined income of just over $120,000 will get around $50 extra per week. A family on similar incomes, but with two children in early childhood care, will be better off by about $126 a week. A single adult earning $55,000 a year will get around $25 a week. A minimum wage earner, $12.50 a week. And a retired couple on super, $4.50 a week, rising to $13. The surprise? It's pretty similar to what National campaigned on. But ahead of the budget unveiling, thousands of protesters turned out in a nationwide day of action against the coalition government's Māori policies. We'll have more on that shortly. First, the One News team's been poring over the budget. Let's head to political editor Mikey Sherman at Parliament.
Kia ora tātou. Well, tax cuts really are the centrepiece of this budget today. We knew it would be a lean budget, a no-frills budget, a hoo-ha budget, depending on who you ask. But tax cuts is something tangible that almost every household will receive. And yes, time will tell if they add to inflation, and the Reserve Bank will certainly be keeping an eye on that. But in the meantime, the National Party can chalk this one up as a win. They campaigned at the election on tax cuts. They were hounded for months over whether or not they were the right idea. Nicola Willis and her government were forced to hold their nerve and hold the line on tax cuts, and today was D-Day, delivery day.
Outside Parliament, they arrived in their thousands. Critical of the government. Inside the beehive, as the budget books were presented, nothing could rain on the Finance Minister's parade.
We had the choice to break our promise to New Zealanders, and we chose not to do that.
Today was all about tax cuts. For the Haida whānau of Hastings, their excitement...
Austin. It's only 80 bucks a fortnight.
...quickly dissipated.
So $40 a week... We might be able to get an extra pack of toilet rolls and maybe a couple of loaves of bread.
This pensioner's tax cut, even less.
An extra two cups of coffee down at the local cafe. Basically, you know, that's how insignificant it really is.
How can you be confident your tax cuts will make a meaningful difference?
Because I've knocked on the doors of New Zealanders who've told me their struggles. The people have said that, you know, $20 a fortnight is the difference between them paying their bills or being in overdraft.
For this working solo mum and her two-year-old son, it's an extra $90 a fortnight.
$90, I feel like it's really good. It helps a lot, or helped me.
But again, more support would be welcome.
I've got to get my son's clothes every month because he's just growing like crazy. Which I don't mind to do, but $90 is not a lot.
Experts today divided.
My personal view is it's a populist play as opposed to the right economic call at this juncture of the cycle.
Adjustments to thresholds are long overdue. It is frankly ridiculous that 14 years have been allowed to pass through.
Labor argues it'll make things worse.
This is a government that is fueling inflation through tax cuts rather than helping to get inflation back down.
Mr. Speaker, tax relief in this budget puts $3.7 billion a year back into the pockets of New Zealanders.
Nicola Willis announced today a surplus by 2027.
How ambitious is that, and will you get there?
We will get there. We're determined to get there. What we also note is that it's only possible with more disciplined spending.
That means the government will give itself less money in future budgets.
The more you progress, move up in regard to spending cuts or identified savings, the more you risk cutting into muscle.
Nicola Willis, though, is resolute, a minister who can now tick off her first budget.
Another big topic today, how the government plans to pay for these tax cuts. Let's head back to Mikey at Parliament. She's joined by our business correspondent, Katie Bradford.
Well, that's right. And as you heard there, in order to pay for these, there have been some big cuts to government departments, Katie, including the first year of tertiary fees free. That is gone. And there will be some increased fees for students also.
And as you heard, the government's operating allowance will be, that's how much cash it has to spend, that will be $3.2 billion this year. It will decrease over the next couple of years and it won't be back in surplus until 2027-2028. Government debt is set to keep increasing from $178 billion this year to $209 billion in 2028. And today's books revealed a gloomier economic picture than even 6 months ago.
These are the families paying for the government's cuts. This Hawke's Bay mum, one of nearly 5,000 to have lost their jobs, for her, this budget means little.
No, not me or anybody else, really. You know, I'm not sure that everybody has considered the, you know, medium to long-term effects.
The government has cut, axed, slashed, sliced and then cobbled together every cent it could find. So gone. Fees free for first-year tertiary students. It'll move to the third year instead, saving nearly $900 million.
I think it's just so tense for students to think ahead of how they have to pay thousands of money for the first year course fee.
And if you have a student loan and jet off overseas, you're going to be paying an extra 1% in interest. Axed, universal free prescriptions. They'll remain free for under 14s, over 65s and community service cardholders.
I feel like it should be free for everyone because there are lots of people out there in this country that also have medical conditions.
And cut 240 programs the coalition thought wasteful, including victims of crime and family violence initiatives, biosecurity monitoring, the Jobs for Nature program, the Symphony Orchestra.
This budget is a shredder. It is completely unimaginative and delivers on trickle-down tax cuts.
There's no money for the 13 cancer drugs National promised during the election, and it's slashed funding for emergency housing, pinning its hopes on solving the housing crisis instead.
So it appears as if the overall aim has been one of politics. How do we deliver a tax cut programme as promised on the road, rather than how do we deliver what's needed economically and socially for the country?
Going up, immigration fees and the tourist tax.
Tourists coming to New Zealand have an exceptional experience.
Plans to keep spending low, essentially zero budgets for the next few years, are dependent on the economic climate not calling further, no global economic headwinds, or any kind of disaster.
Quite a long list in here of fiscal risks, time-limited funding, including on things like plans to decrease spending on emergency housing. Given you plan to decrease the operating allowance, do you accept that you may have to spend more in the next couple of years?
We will have to be in a constant process of reducing risks elsewhere, evaluating what investments will make the biggest difference, and ensuring that we're looking for waste and rooting it out.
All of that cold comfort to those at the tough end of those government cuts.
And of course, there are some ministries that are also facing massive cuts. You're talking customs, agriculture, Māori and Pacific people. They are getting absolutely no new funding in this budget. Department of Conservation getting just $1 million. All up, those cuts equal $1.5 billion. And if you think the cuts end there, think again. Nicola Willis is going to come in here with her red pen every year and slash and burn again and again and again.
And there are some big economic risks with that, eh, Katie?
Yeah, and Treasury laid that out today, the gloomy economic picture, some of those fiscal risks I talked about in my track there. Some specific things, if we had another pandemic again, a massive disaster, that would be a problem, but also some very specific programs and projects. If we saw infrastructure cost blowouts, that population growth, that could add to the pain as well. There is no doubt things are going to get worse, it's going to get harder, they're going to hope that those economic risks don't happen so that they can make those spending cuts and those operational allowances less than they hoped for. That's the big economic picture.
And look, the reality of this budget is that it will hurt. And for those opposition parties, this budget cuts right to the core of their values. We're talking about the environment, Māori, Pacifica. It's not just about the budgets being slashed for these ministries. It's about the services that they represent and the people who rely on them and who need to use them. So expect the opposition parties parties to pore over this large budget document over the coming weeks to pick it apart, and they will surely come up with some more criticism in the coming weeks.
Yeah, no doubt the opposition parties will be busy, but how are the coalition, how's the government feeling today?
I think from a government perspective, it could be argued that they largely had no other choice. We have all seen the economic outlook. It is grim. It is getting worse day by day. And so, look, the coalition, they campaigned on reining in government spending, on tightening that belt inch by inch. That is certainly what they've done today. Nicola Willis and Christopher Luxon, they promised heading into this budget that they would make some bold calls, and we've certainly seen that.
Kia ora kōrua. We'll see you both again soon. As thousands of jobs go in the public sector, Nicola Willis's big promise is that the money's going to the front line, meaning more health workers in hospitals, more teachers in schools. So will this budget make a difference? Senior political reporter Benedict Collins spoke to some of those at the coalface.
Law and order was on the mind of this Aucklander as he digested today's budget.
I do appreciate the government's efforts doing a lot of things to curb the crime.
It's a far cry from when he was attacked at this gas station earlier this year.
Yeah, it was very horrific. I never expected that I'm going to be a victim.
To fight back, the government wants 500 more cops on the beat. New vehicles are coming for police dog units and the armed offenders squad, and new police boats too. But Mr. Majeed doesn't think all this will stop youth offenders.
If they don't have the fear of the consequence of the car crime, they won't stop doing it.
Health is another priority. It's getting $17 billion over three budgets.
What we want to see is the things New Zealanders want to see. Shorter waiting times in the emergency room, shorter waiting times for specialist assessment.
This barely keeps the lights on in the health system, and we actually know more investment is needed.
Those on the front line say the key is getting the money to where it will make the most difference.
What it should look like is many more general practitioners. We are 500 general practitioners short as we stand.
The government's plan is to train 25 extra doctors a year.
There's a decimal point missing there, really, to be honest with you. 250 would be a good start. 25, that's astonishingly low.
Education got a hit of funding too, almost $3 billion over the next 4 years. About half of that's going on new classrooms.
Oh, absolutely. It is definitely needed.
There's money for new teachers too, but this principal says there's something missing.
Teachers, principals, learning assistants across the country are crying out for support in the learning support space, and I didn't really see that. What I did see was I saw some funding, $153 million, going to charter schools, and I think that's almost an experiment that we're prepared to try in this country.
This government's first budget, getting mixed feedback.
Benedict's with us now. Kia ora, Benedict. The government's hoping some of the funding for the police might solve a headache they've got. Can you tell us about that?
Well, it is indeed. The government and the police have been locked in a pretty tense pay dispute. Police officers describe the government's most recent offer as a kick in the guts, farcical and an absolute joke. And that's not a great position for a government to be in when it's trying to hire 500 more police officers to keep its promise to the public. So in today's budget, there was $240 million allocated to help boost police pay. And the Finance Minister, Nicola Willis, she said she hopes that this starts to put things right with the police. Now, the Police Association told me today that they welcome this extra money, and you get the feeling they probably think it's about time.
Tēnā te mihi, Atu. Thanks very much, Benedict. More than $1 billion is promised to help rebuild communities affected by Cyclone Gabrielle and the Auckland anniversary weekend floods. Most of that goes to NZTA to rebuild roads and local councils to continue recovery work, including helping households still displaced. $10 million will be spent on a new national emergency management facility in Wellington, which recent reviews declared not fit for purpose. And organisations who helped out during the storm, such as Surf Life Saving and the Coast Guard, get just over $20 million to replace damaged equipment. An additional $1.1 billion will go to services funded by Whaikaha, the Ministry for Disabled People, for the next 5 years. The ministry came under fire earlier this year after cutting funding to services due to a shortfall. The new spending includes a pre-budget commitment to see the ministry through to the end of the next financial year. NATA scenes never before seen on Budget Day. Peaceful protests held right across the country. The Māori Party calling for mass action, fighting against the coalition government's Māori policies. Crowds descending on Parliament as part of the nationwide Hīkoi. Here's Yvonne Tahana.
Hours before the budget lockup even began, Kiwis right across the country were gathering.
Very cool and exciting, like I'm getting shivers down my back.
Determined to make every moment count, at 7:20, those on Auckland's North Shore kicked off the Hīkoi with a kākoi.
We want to see the treaty honoured.
All making their way here to Aotea Square, a chance for some to raise what they see as the government's red flags.
They talk to us about we all carry on like we're privileged. You know, is it a privilege to live in deprived areas and crap housing, crap education, and with a crap justice system? Is that privilege?
The scrapping of Te Aka Whai Ora, the repeal of Section 7AA, the status of Te Reo Māori, and the mooted repeal of various treaty clauses across government, drawing tens of thousands of Māori out to events like these across the country. It all happened as the government was locked up in its budget announcement in Wellington.
Except for new Te Matatini spending at $49 million over 3 years, there is almost no new targeted funding for Māori.
So we have a budget that is absolutely adverse to any Māori transformational solution.
Well, there's actually no funding cuts for any race of people.
This is a budget that delivers for Māori, it delivers for all New Zealanders.
There is a multiple list of budget cuts here directly affecting Māori.
I reject that assertion.
Budget days, what do you make of them normally?
Gee, that's every day for us, we've got a budget day.
Yeah, definitely, definitely, and we've always sort of gone off on an oily rag, but we make magic happen.
From Napier to Dunedin, to Hamilton, and Tauranga, the message was the same. A sense that while Budget Day is about dollars and cents, many disagree with where that's going. Yvonne Tahana, One News.
Opposition parties have also come out swinging, with Labor calling it a budget of broken promises. Here's some more political reaction.
There was one major test that Nicola Willis had to pass in today's budget, that she to demonstrate clearly that she was not borrowing to pay for tax cuts. And this budget fails at the first hurdle. $10 billion worth of tax cuts, $12 billion worth of borrowing. You don't need an abacus to figure out that this is a government borrowing to pay for tax cuts.
This budget is not so much a vision for the future of this country, one that invests in dealing with the inequality crisis and the climate crisis. This budget is a shredder. It is completely unimaginative and delivers on trickle-down tax cuts.
What we've received so far is absolutely dismal and a slight on this place and this government that is in its twilight stage.
Returning to our budget coverage, and tax cuts are on the way for some Kiwis, with an average income household receiving up to $102 a fortnight. Eligible families will also get a childcare payment of up to $150 a fortnight. These kick in from July 31st. Frontline services are also big winners, with nearly $17 billion committed across three budgets to the health sector. But prescription fees have been reinstated for those over 14 years old. While our police force will receive $651 million over 4 years, some of that going to delivering an extra 500 officers. And New Zealand First has got its regional infrastructure fund across the line, with $1.2 billion being allocated over the next 3 years. Kushla Norman reports.
Wided Upper getting battered a couple of years ago. Flood protection, like stop banks, now set to benefit from the $1.2 billion regional infrastructure fund. It was a New Zealand First coalition promise, but the criteria for what gets funded is still to be signed off.
But if you can view it in this way, will it boost regional productivity? Will it actually unleash through private-public ventures which it will be entitled to proceed with, and how will it practically deal with climate adaptation.
More than 40 stop banks and walls across the country are in line for funding. Initially, $200 million will be spent on flood-related infrastructure. The Greater Wellington Regional Council has about a dozen projects in the pipeline.
The work in southern Hawke's Bay in relation to stop bank work is estimated to have saved billions of dollars in compensation.
But some say while stop banks are important, they're a knee-jerk solution to a warming world.
What we need now is for this government and all political parties to have a much more comprehensive and engaged approach to how we're going to protect New Zealanders into the future. Because it's not just the flooding that's the problem, it's the fires, it's our security in homes.
New Zealanders that bug me in regional New Zealand, they don't want to wait for another meeting about climate change in Geneva. They want the bridge, they want the stop bank fixed up ASAP.
Infrastructure spend is forecast to hit a record this year. The government is adding another $7.5 billion to the pot. The finance minister says replacements for the Cook Strait ferries could come out of that, although nothing was allocated today.
But one of the small items that the government has committed to is some feasibility funding for to look at a tugboat to save ferries and other shipping.
Billion-dollar commitments for some of the biggest challenges we face. Kushla Norman, One News.
Well, Mikey Sherman and Katie Bradford are back with us now from Parliament. We're interested to know, what were your takeaways from Budget 2024?
We must remember this is a budget that has been delivered in the toughest economic times since the GFC. It is gloomy out there, and it is hard for government to come in at a time like this with a new budget and appeal to voters, live up to those promises, etc. It was a very fine line for the government today, right, that they had to walk between an austerity budget and not splashing the cash, between giving people something they want while looking fiscally responsible, which of course is something that National prides itself on.
And certainly the government today didn't want this budget to be one of austerity, but looking ahead, it is hard to see that it won't tip that way in future budgets going forward. Of course, the government needs to remember, when you make the bold calls today, you have to live with the consequences of those tomorrow. And so the government will be needing to brace for impact of the reality, the cold, hard reality of some of those tough decisions that were made today. Will we see more people homeless? Will we see more people lining up for food parcels? Will we see more people heading overseas to make a decent living?
And of course, when the dust settles as well and everyone has a chance to have a look at this, they might go, sure, I'm getting $20 a week in the pocket, great, everyone wants that. But they might also say, hey, I'm a big fan of the Symphony Orchestra. I like the Jobs for Nature program. I'd prefer money was going into family violence. Whatever their pet project, the thing that really matters to them, seeing that cut, that could hurt them, that could hurt the government. That's the sort of choices people have to make. We are in a cost of living crisis, a housing crisis, an infrastructure crisis. There are so many problems the country faces, and those are, the tough choices the government has to make, just like everyone else has to make with their budgets.
And this is why the biggest challenge for the government moving forward over the next 3 years is taking the public with them. They will need to remind the public and voters exactly why these tough times are needed, why we are needing to tighten our belts in the way that we are as a nation, and they'll need to convince them that this is the right path, because soon enough people may soon forget all about that tax cut and they will feel the cold, hard reality of these decisions today. Of course, that's it for Budget 2024 from Parliament. Katie, thank you very much for joining us today. And we'll send it back to you, Melissa, for the government. It's been a big day.
E mihi ana kia kōrua. Our thanks to Mikey and Katie for all your analysis tonight, and to the whole team at Parliament.